I can talk about film. Sleeping, sobbing, streaming. Tell me, Derek, what movie in the end did we decide? I can open your eyes. Drugs can't replace the wonder. That's what you will want after joining our magical tour inside our childhood films. They tend to age quite badly too, but now you've tuned on in, it makes us grin. It's lucky you picked Disney's Aladdin. Did you dare hold you? Can this please
a thrilling chase,
a podcasting place for you and me?
Hello, I'm Derek.
And I'm Peter.
And this is The Mog.
In this podcast, one of us suggests a beloved movie from our childhood for the other to watch. And then we talk about it. What made us laugh? What made us cry?
And whether or not it explains our aversion to live-action remakes.
I'm definitely against that now.
Aversion, a feeling of intense dislike.
Intensities. So I'm not going to ask what the movie is today because everyone should know it by now if you've actually listened to what happened beforehand.
It's Aladdin from 1992.
That's it, or as I'd like to call it, Prince of Persia. Or I'm not crying, it's just sand in my eye.
Oh, nice. Prince of Persia, that reminded me of this too, hey?
Yeah. What, did you have any alternatives?
It was Princess Jasmine, Let's Aladdin, if you know what I mean. Nyuk, nyuk, nyuk. I didn't write that joke. I stole it.
Oh, man, you're in good form tonight. Good form.
There were so many puns, though.
You stole it. Man, you had so many to choose from and you stole the worst one. Good work.
Yeah, true. Did you have any other puns?
Oh, well, no, not puns. Oh. No, I'm probably taking it a little bit from G to PG to hopefully not too far into M. But we'll, you know, double entendres are always good. So we'll get to it when we come to it.
Oh, that's good.
Get it. Sorry. So how about I do a synopsis?
Sounds good.
When street rat Aladdin frees a genie from a lamp, he finds his wishes granted. However, he soon finds that the evil has other plans for the lamp and for Princess Jasmine in the form of Jafar the Vizier. But can Aladdin save Princess Jasmine, his love for her, after she sees that he isn't quite what he appears to be?
Oh, wow. That's a nice dramatic introduction to this movie.
Thank you. So, background to this film, Derek.
I have like a little bit of stuff, but because this is a Disney film, this is really our first full feature animated film, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, actually. That's very true. Unless you count City of Lost Children.
Well, we had Phantom Tollbooth, but that was sort of half-half.
Yeah, and Bedknobs and Broomsticks was like a fifth.
That was at Disney?
Yeah.
Oh, it was. Okay. Yeah.
I didn't think Phantom Tollbooth was Disney.
No, that definitely wasn't Disney. Yeah. There were drugs involved in that one.
Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, God, yeah.
But the directors of this are Ron Clemens and John Musker, and they seem to have worked closely together with one another. So they made The Little Mermaid in 1989.
Oh, yeah.
And they're still going strong with films like Moana in 2016. Did you see that?
No. Was it any good?
I really loved that. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's a really great story. Yeah.
Oh, cool.
And they did Hercules as well and The Prince and the Frog.
Okay. So they did the animation versions of stuff.
Well, they started it off, really. Like Little Mermaid was the first sort of resurgence of animation, I feel.
Oh, man. It was pretty much the golden years with these films, wasn't it? Yeah. Beauty and the Beast, Mermaid, and Aladdin. Just, really just timeless.
Yeah. And like as a kid, you know, when I saw these Disney films, I wanted to be an animator because I sort of sketched and drew and things like that. And it was like the ultimate dream back then to animate. How did you feel about it?
Oh, look, I loved it. And I was a little bit resistant when they started to introduce like, 3D digital.
Yeah.
Because I really loved the, the painted animation. It was, I always found it really beautiful.
Yeah.
And you could always tell when they'd done a good job or when they'd just done a half-assed job because they had like the sequel to Aladdin, didn't they? That was not quite up to snuff in terms of the quality of animation. Right.
Yeah. I do have lots of sort of trivia and info on the animators themselves, but I'll sort of talk about that as we go through the film.
Oh, okay.
But this film was 1992, which was actually the biggest grossing film of that year.
Oh, wow.
$500 million worldwide. On a budget of $28 million.
Oh, wow.
So it's the first animation, feature to win over $200 million in revenue. So this was a huge win for Disney.
You could almost call it the whole new world of Disney.
Whole new world
there
of
you
Disney.
Go. There's your pun for you. Is that a pun? I don't know.
Sort of. That's funny. And this is the same year as The Bodyguard and Home Alone 2 and Batman Returns.
So all very similar storylines.
Rags to riches. But it was really just a platform for Robin Williams, I felt.
Yeah.
For his comedic talent, just like his... It was very well suited to him.
It was. And what I found really interesting when I was sort of looking into the background of this was that Robin Williams did this with the understanding that Disney wouldn't be using his name to sort of advertise the film as an attraction.
Right.
And he was really pissed with Disney because they reneged on their promise.
Oh, my gosh.
And he was really dirty with them for a while.
Wow.
Yeah.
Because he was working with them on Hook, I do believe, prior to this, the Peter Pan story, the live action version of that.
Yeah. Well, I don't know exactly like the full details of it, but I have heard that, he was pretty upset with them over what they did. And I think he's made a few jokes in the past about Disney. And
oh, right. Yeah. Okay, that's sad. Ooh. I do know that he worked on this film for the lowest pay grade because he really loved the project.
Right.
And so it makes sense that he didn't want his work to be exploited by the moneymaker machine that Disney's turned into.
That's how they attracted him to it, wasn't it? They took some of his skits that had been recorded and they did animation over the top of them, and that's how they kind of won him in. So they showed some of his some of their animations
over his stand-up.
Yeah,
that's amazing. Hey,
and he was apparently laughing his ass off.
That's awesome. When I was researching this film and they showed video of like the voice actors, you can really see that they're just giving it their 100% enthusiasm. Mm. And it's not just vocally and emotionally, they're full on physical.
Oh, really?
It's incredible to watch. Robin particularly, he's got such quick wit and he's just chopping and changing and, twisting. And there's 60 different characters.
Oh,
that
really?
He
60,
in this.
Wow. And so much ad-libbing. Apparently, Gilbert Gottfried, the person who did Iago the Parrot.
Oh, I love him.
He
man.
Did a lot of that as well. It was kind of funny because I was listening to some, background on this. And as soon as his voice comes in, I can't imagine anything but the parrot talking because it's such a presence.
It's so synonymous,
his voice,
right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So memorable. Mm. But this film, if we talk about the background, it was from the collection of stories, The Arabian Nights from 850 AD. And I learned this from The Making Of, which had John Rhys-Davies
Gimli
as the narrator. Yeah. It reminded me so much of the Kevin Costner Making Of with Pierce Brosnan. It was in the same, it must have been the same guys.
Really? Did he have quotes? Like, did he have Shakespearean quotes kicked in there?
But there was so much history, and like there was a silent film which was in 1924, which had The Flying Carpet, The Thief of Baghdad, and
all right.
Yeah, little interesting things like that. I thought that was kind of cool.
I think in the original Aladdin story, he wasn't an orphan. He had a mum, and there was no magic carpet.
Yeah.
And he had infinite wishes.
Oh, my God. Where's the story?
I think that they discussed a lot of that when they were figuring out the plot, and that the constraints of three wishes and all of that really helped the plot along and keep it tight. And I got to say...
Yeah, there were the two guys, Ted Elliott and Terry Rossio. They sort of saved the script, apparently, by getting rid of a lot of these things.
Yeah, and developing the character of Aladdin was tough.
Oh.
Because how do you... Like, because there's so many, you know, the heroes in all of the Disney films, you know, they're all generic princes. So, how do you make it a little bit different? How do you make it a bit more interesting? And... You know, that whole street rat and figuring out who he is sort of, they had to figure that out to make the character more interesting and approachable.
Yeah, right. I see. Oh, well, they did a good job because he's, I think he's the first non-white prince. Just going to say
Another piece of trivia, I think, and this is me going off memory, but apparently in the cinemas, they were a lot more white. But when they released like the DVD version and stuff, they actually shaded the colors in a bit more.
Oh, a little bit of color correcting.
Yeah. You could almost say that they were anti-whitewashing. So.
Oh wow. Okay.
Yeah.
So playing it safe.
Yeah. But I always have loved the characters in this.
Oh, it's so memorable. So that makes me wonder how has this film touched you?
I tell you what, it helped spark my obsession with the game Prince of Persia.
Oh yes,
because I just had this huge obsession with Arabian Nights and all of that type of stuff with Prince of Persia. My dad used to have a tape of Arabian Nights that I used to listen to.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And
is it long? I haven't really had much exposure to it.
Well, it's 1001. Yeah, 1001 Arabian Nights, I think it's called, where originally the story is based around a princess trying to save her life by keep telling stories so that the prince that she's married to won't kill her.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Right.
There's a bit more to the story, but... Yeah, so she told 1001 tales, and by the end of it, you know, he just couldn't bring his heart to kill her or something like that.
Oh,
so,
that's beautiful.
Yeah, well, kind of, I guess so. If you imagine that, you know, a psychopathic prince ends up not killing you as the best outcome.
Oh, that's good that you had this audio, though.
Yeah, I used to like listening to it. I can't remember too much about it, but I know that it was sort of part of my upbringing. And, you know, Prince of Persia, surprisingly, the big difference between Prince of Persia and this is that he basically doesn't use a sword at all in this film.
Yeah, it's very peaceful. He's very pacifistic.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right. He does a little bit, but... It's not really sword fighting.
Yeah, it's more for show.
Yeah. I also remember this was a bit of a guilty pleasure for me as well, because it was sort of like the I'm not crying type that movie for me, because I thought it was, you know, like the some of the songs were soppy, and I was, you know, growing up, it was just like, oh, you know, teenagers don't like these kinds of film. They just don't like that. We're grown up. We're men.
Well, that was the thing. This was at the cusp, wasn't it? Mm. We're reaching that age, you and I, where we're sort of too big for animated Disney
that's
films.
Right.
And it was one of the last ones I saw with my whole family.
Mm.
I saw this in the cinema, which was quite good. And I think my mum went to Indrapilli. And I actually have vivid memories while watching this film of this 1962 animation Arabian Nights, The Adventures of Sinbad.
I don't know
if you ever saw that.
Maybe.
Osamu Tezuka wrote it, who did Astro Boy.
Oh, wow.
And I think that was a real inspiration for this movie. It had the similar sort of feel to it, this very mystical and, you know, he had the puffy pants and he was a very innocent sort of heroic character.
Oh, right.
And it's such a cool movie. It should be a mini-mog of mine, I think.
Oh.
It's on YouTube. But I love Robin Williams, man. My dad loves him too.
Mm.
And I love his comedy. Good Morning Vietnam, Mork and Mindy, Dead Poets Society.
Yeah.
I was all into all of that. And so I think the genie in this makes the comedies so accessible.
Oh, it really...
And memorable as well.
Yeah, it makes this film so memorable. He does steal the show. But I guess... Yeah, but at the same time, it's also just like, I like the characters, not just the genie, but he really does just change the movie for the better.
Yeah, and great songs. I still remember A Whole New World.
I always loved the first song that came in the Arabian Nights one. It's so short, but
it sets
I really
the scene
enjoyed
so
it.
Well, hey.
Mm. And yeah, well, quickly, there we have both had a look at the new live action film, so I will be doing a bit of a comparison club, going back and talking a bit about the difference between the two every now and then.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I have too. Mm. And I actually saw the live musical version when it came to Sydney.
Oh, wow.
And it was also played by a black actor. But they sort of played the black card in this thing, you know, the humor, like, you know.
Oh, you mean in the live
in the
action
musical.
Movie? Oh, in the musical.
Yeah, they played. I think it's a thing because it's in the script. I don't know, but and it felt uncomfortable.
Was that the genie or the main character?
The genie was, resorting to sort of race-based humor.
I don't get that. And it's strange too, because you've got race-based humor about a completely different race playing a character in a completely different race.
Yeah, I know.
It's it's just, and man, I've got so there's just so much about the new live action thing that just so bad.
Yeah,
it'll be.
You're going to talk about those as we go, though.
Yeah, I don't want to go into it just now. But
there was also I remember the animated TV series, and it wasn't Robin Williams. It makes sense now that he quit because it was Dan Castellaneta, the voice of Homer Simpson.
Yeah.
He was doing the genie, and I could never tell the difference. He did such a good job.
Oh, really? I could tell straight away.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm just going from memory, like back then.
Oh, there was something about, like, I lost interest in anything that wasn't based, like, if I could tell that a voice actor wasn't the same voice actor, and I was just like, okay, I'm not interested.
Well, that was my ritual, man. Saturday Disney. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And Cheese TV, Aggro's Cartoon Connection.
Man,
did you
there
watch
were
these?
So many ads.
Oh, so
like,
many.
Like, there was more ads than there was stuff to watch. I just remember the frustration, like the anxiety of waiting for these ads to end so I could actually watch the bloody...
It was like every 10 minutes. And this is a whole animation side of cartoons that this sort of opened up for me when I sort of thought about it. Like, I've never really, there was a large portion of my childhood where I was just watching cartoons nonstop.
Me too. Yeah, my interest in cartoons. I love Batman the Animated Series.
Most perfect thing ever.
Oh, God. And other things too, like Danger Mouse.
Oh, Danger Mouse.
Trapdoor, which is more of a claymation. But
yeah, all the ABC stuff. It's great.
Yeah,
there was a Mega Drive game of this that I played, Aladdin.
Yeah.
It was a clunky platformer. Definitely apparently, no Prince of Persia, though.
No. As soon as I saw it, I was just like, is there sword fighting in it?
There
is. Or is it just slashing?
But throwing apples and stuff, I think. Is the thing.
Yeah. No, for me, like, the thing about Prince of Persia was that you actually sword fight.
Yeah.
Like, you you would block and attack and block and attack.
It was a really good mechanic. I think that's how you and I bonded. We were in IT class and you told me that you were into Prince of Persia.
And I used to draw Prince of Persia maps.
Yeah, with all the spikes.
Like I used to make them up. Yeah,
the corpses in the bottom. This is going to be a short one. We should move along.
Yeah. Okay.
Into Act One.
So, what's your Act One?
I grab ya some hot tamale. Agrabah. I grab ya.
Oh, God, man. No. Puns. Oh. Okay. Well, mine aren't like that. Sorry.
That's good.
But this is Act One for me is this is where I play with my monkey.
Oh, the monkey jokes there, the entendre.
Yeah, I told you. I warned you. I warned you. Yeah, but there's something real. So when it introduces the characters, there's something really endearing about them. Even though they're very American, you know, the people who did the voiceovers, I did find them just the animation and the voice acting just made them very endearing.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's sort of introduced by that narrator, and that was Robin Williams.
It was.
You know that guy? Yeah. And apparently they just put a tablecloth of stuff and they put him in the room and they said, just describe the stuff. It was all improvised.
We're not break. So it broke.
Yeah, with no break. And like there was 16 hours of material.
Oh my God.
Because of all of Robin's improvisations.
Oh my gosh. That's crazy.
It's crazy. Yeah.
That'd be so good to listen to. Though it would be exhausting. That's the only thing about Robin Williams is just the so much energy.
Yeah.
That it's just so full on. But I did love the intro music to as I said, to
Arabian Nights. Yeah.
And it's really short. And one thing that going comparison club here, looking at the live action, one thing that I noticed looking at the new one was realizing how great the pacing was in this film. It's so tight. Like,
right. It is. It's only an hour and a half. But they've really, they've cut it all down, cut away all the fat. There's no mother. There's no unlimited wishes. Yeah. Don't need a mother.
Yeah. And like, you know, it starts on a dark night. You know, I love there's something great for
it. Yeah. Dark night, dark man with a dark
purpose. So good. And of course, the live action just glosses over that completely. It just goes like swipes straight past it. It's like you know the bits, but yeah, just that was so great. I love the mystery and you know it hooks you right into it with the whole mystery and what's going on.
Yeah, and then you're introduced to Jafar really, and that character design. He looks so evil. You just love it. His voice too. Yeah. It's like Jeremy Irons.
I
thought it was him, but it's Jonathan Freeman.
Yeah, yeah.
And but he's got such a great voice.
And did you know that he actually performed the live action Jafar? Not the live action, but the musical. He actually performed as Jafar.
Oh, right. He doesn't look anything like him, though. He's quite chubby. Yeah.
Maybe they just made him taller or something.
It is about the voice, though.
Yeah. It's a great voice. And, it's so, I don't know what the word, like smooth.
Yeah. And, I looked up some of the stuff about all the animators and there's a whole bunch of them. There's Andreas Deja. He was the lead Jafar animator. And he says, I think that villains motivate the story. Without villains, you'd have a happy land and nothing would happen. It'd be very boring. And he said about Jafar and Iago, they're very different characters, but they think about the same thing. And I thought that was quite cool just to see the contrast between the two. That's why it sort of that dynamic works.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it? Because like just the nature of Jafar, you'd think that he would be very just completely just ignore Iago, but he actually does listen to him as well.
Yeah, they're on the same thought pattern. Yeah, I kind of like that. And with Iago, I just love, man, the, what's the actor again?
Gilbert Gottfried.
Yeah. Oh, gosh. So he just completely goes off the deep end. He's ranting and raving.
It's so good. Like, you know, that he plays the character of the parrot until everyone's gone, and then he's himself with Jafar.
Yeah. Oh, it's perfect. And the animator for him was Will Finn, and he says, you take that ranting and raving, and then you put the posture of shrugged shoulders, the palms out, and he's tearing out his hair, and he's complaining all the time, squinting his eyes.
I'm so mad I'm molting.
Yeah, the sort of Jewish borscht belt comedian comedy.
He's so good. Yeah. So that in terms of Act One, that's the introduction of the characters, introduction of the, you know, Aladdin and Jasmine and Abu and the street rat.
And they're looking for the diamond in the rough.
Yes.
Because they enter the Cave of Wonders and the guy failed. So, and then we're introduced to Aladdin. Yeah. He's the thief. And they had like a Back to the Future moment.
Oh, really?
They run into crazy Hakim's discount fertilizer. Oh, and there's manure. Yeah,
that's true. Falls on
that's it. True. Manure. I hate manure.
And it's actually, there's parts in this that are quite, not dark, well, dark, but in that she almost gets her arm chopped off.
Yeah.
There's a real genuine danger there. And in the... in live action, they just lighten everything. It's all just so lightened up. There's no danger or anything. It's just like, you know. Oh.
I was surprised by that because it's Guy Ritchie. He's the guy that did Snatch, and I really thought it'd be a little bit darker.
Oh my gosh, it was like a padded down musical.
Mm.
They skipped all the best bits, the scary lion, and you know, and the mystery and...
But there were some nice touches in the original, stuff. Like in the chase scene, there's a bit of foreshadowing. He jumps off in the carpet and he uses it as a parachute. But there's a moment where he's flying, you know, flying it. And that stuff, like little touches like that. And he gives the food to the poor kids. I mean, it was done in the new one, but Abu gives the food too. And that's like little icing on the cake, you know?
Yeah, that's right. Because it also sets the personality of the two as well. Abu's a bit more reluctant, a giver.
Yeah.
And, you know, Aladdin's more natural in that way. Yeah, it's just really tight introducing the nature of the characters and you know, just their attitudes and their thoughts and beliefs. And, you know, how they're seen in greater society.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, yeah, no, really tight. And when he gets introduced to the princess and they hit it off. And I like it how, you know, she isn't completely without her own level of independence as well. You know, she can hop across buildings as well as he can.
Yeah, she's quite empowered, hey. And she's got Raja, the sidekick, the tiger.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, you know, traditional princess storyline, you know, she's due to be married and she doesn't want to pick any of the suitors.
Yeah. And I like that Jafar, the most trusted advisor, you know, he looks so evil when you introduce his backlit and he's got this twisted goatee, this pencil thin moustache, and he has a serpent staff.
Yeah, I mean, it's really, you need the Sultan to be as stupid as he is in order for him to believe that Jafar is as good, like, you know, to believe he's a trusted advisor.
And it reminded me of this Mitchell and Webb Nazi skit. Have you looked at our caps? These two Nazis saying to each other. Right. They've got skulls on them. Yeah. Our caps
do
have little pictures.
The bad, do you think maybe we're the bad guys?
I can't really think of anything worse than a symbol than a skull. a rat's anus. Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Really, when do you think it goes from the end of the first act? I thought it was around when Abu sets off the chain reaction and they're trapped in the cave.
Yeah, I thought so too. Yeah. So, what was your act two?
Act two, I just rub against it and my wishes come true. Or I had another one. You ever ridden a magic carpet?
What's that?
Have you? You ever ridden a magic carpet, eh? Say no more.
Oh,
say no
right,
more.
Right. Okay, gotcha. Say no more. I just say Act 2. I Dream of Jeannie. I used to love that show too.
Yeah.
Do you remember?
Yeah. Barbara Eden. I had a bit of a
1965.
What was it? Gosh. Elka Summers, wasn't it? Was the actress?
Barbara Eden, I think.
Barbara Eden.
Maybe there was a different one.
I don't know.
There were some cool little things in that cave scene, though. Like the carpet animation. It's just beautiful, man.
Yeah. Well,
so much character.
Yeah. And that was the first 3D animation that they really put into their films, I believe.
Yeah. Amazing. Really. They did such a good job. It's just classic Disney. It reminded me of a bit of Alice in Wonderland, you know, 1951, the playing cards.
Oh, yeah.
Sort of walk around in the corners. Mm. But I love all the framing as well. Like, he had to climb that huge diagonal thing. Mm. It's really dramatic. They just use all these lines. And one of the animators, Richard Vandervelt, he says it's all of the curves in the calligraphy, the S curves, these sort of asymmetrical things in Arabic writing. He was using that as an influence for all of this sort of style, the really curvy style. And when Genie finally appears, the animator for him, Eric Goldberg, this was his first Disney film, and he was saying he used Al Hirschfeld, who was a sort of caricature artist, as his inspiration. These really curvy lines and... Yeah, it's kind of inspiring when you see like how much thought went into just like the design of these characters, because they're really unforgettable. They're very unique and hadn't really seen anything like them before, I think.
Mm. Yeah, I must admit I didn't have a huge observation about the styling that goes into the animation, but it did always strike me as very... attractive, for want of a better word, very polished and professional. It did seem like a motion picture type animation rather than something simple or boring or cheap.
Yeah. Well, it struck home to me when I was watching the live action that you're missing all of this stuff, and these little things are huge giving to the story and to the characters.
There seemed to be a lot more, I guess, like the investment in it. If that makes sense. Like everyone put a piece of themselves into this film. That's what it seemed to me like.
Yeah, absolutely. The animator for Aladdin, Glenn Keane, he was saying, we're really all animating ourselves as young men growing up and experiencing for the first time, you fall in love with a girl and you put that on a screen. And that's what I think makes Aladdin stand out from any other character film. And he based Aladdin on MC Hammer.
Oh, God, really?
With the fans, yep.
No, don't say that. You're ruining it.
It's the same dude. Same thing.
Oh, God.
That's funny.
Well, the Jasmine character was actually based on the artist's sister.
Yeah, I kind of like that. And it shows, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, and all the other artists were asking whether she was single.
Were they? Mark Henn, that's the guy who animated Jasmine.
I always thought that she was the best princess. She was my favorite.
Yeah, she had a lot of grace in her. Hey.
Yeah, and I liked the voice and just the expressions and stuff of the character was really good.
Yeah. And it makes sense because he was basing this on his sister. So there's that very tenderly sort of detail of how she moves.
Yeah, that must be it. Very personal.
And so they finally get out of the cave.
Well, they get introduced to the genie, of course.
Yes.
And there's so much Aladdin nibbling.
That was smooth.
Oh, it's so bad. I wrote it down. I was going to practice it, but yeah.
And when he's introduced, there's some references I never got, like as a kid. Just like there's so many hard and fast references.
Oh, yeah.
There's like
all of these actors
right here, direct from the lamp, Ed Sullivan, and bring back people from the dead, Peter Lorre.
Yeah. Oh, man, it's just, he's got, what is it, Joe Dangerfield or what's his name?
Rodney Dangerfield.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Man, so many. There's just, like, they come so hard and fast and so quick, and he just, like, takes center stage, he really does.
Yeah, And I thought you were going to compare him to Will at this point.
Well, I'll let you do it first.
Oh, okay. Let me see what I said. I don't have any... I didn't explicitly say anything, but with Will, when he first came in the new one, it's like, even just the way he talks, it's Arabian Nights. Arabian Nights. Oh, man. And he's just not trying. I don't think he was trying to either to compete with Robin Williams.
I thought when he was first introduced, he was supposed to, like, the first part was dodgy. And then he tried harder or something like that.
Really?
Wasn't it? I don't know. I didn't actually think Will Smith was that bad. I think he did help the movie as much as it could be helped.
Yeah.
No, I didn't think he did a bad job. But he had...
He plays it very differently.
Yeah. Like, and I think he'd have to.
It's much more macho and... I don't know.
I think he'd have to, though. You can't really, you know, Robin Williams was such an original personality and character. I mean, to try to present him as that character is just, I think it was impossible. I think that's why they picked Will Smith, because he was his own personality, and they were hoping that that would add something to the film. And I think it did a little.
Yeah.
I just don't think that it was as well directed, well put together. I mean, one thing that just, if we're talking about Act Two, just the way that Jafar and the father both speak with accents, but the main cast all have American accents.
Yeah.
Like, it's so jarring.
Yeah.
Like, it's like in this, the animation, you know, they're all speaking with English accents of some description, whether it's American or more Englishy, but they're all kind of American. But in the live action, like, that, it's just like her father's like, "Oh, that's a photo for," and then she's like, "I already heard. How are you going? Let's go down the pub."
Hardy har.
What's that you gotta say? I'm Persian. What are you talking about? Mystery.
Hardy har. Oh,
God. Like, you know, if you're going to be American, just be American. Don't pretend. It's just...
I like that Americans hardy har, though. That's the best thing.
I don't know.
I know what you mean. No, absolutely. Yeah. Oh,
yeah. But
and it's the British director, so I don't know. It just makes sense.
I'm sure that there was probably like some people telling him, you have to respect the culture, and but at the same time you have to hire American actors, and we don't want the main actors to speak with an accent, because then that's not true to the characters or some. I don't know. I'm just making it up. But
right.
There's probably a stupid reason. But anyway, yeah. So the genie lets him out, got three wishes, makes him a prince. Tell me if I'm glossing too quick.
No, and, go for it.
And he gets introduced to the princess, and he's awkward and doesn't really hit it off with her off the bat. And I must admit, as a, you know, little boy, young man growing up, I really liked that dynamic about her not recognizing him, her thinking that the person that she was interested in had been killed, and that, you know, her coming to know who it really was. And that, you know, that bit where he goes, "Do you trust me?" And it's the same image. And
yeah, it's a very sweet moment.
She starts to have that suspicion. I must admit, it kind of gets me a little.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, deep in the recesses of my blackened heart. You know? And, you know, I always used to say that I hated the song, you know, "A Whole New World." But, I don't know. I don't know. I think with age comes... comes a bit of pathetic romanticism or something. I don't know.
Oh, that's sweet. That's very sweet. Oh, it absolutely melts your heart. The duet, the harmonies. I loved it.
Yeah. Or it's just the wine. I don't know. But
But the music was by Alan Menken, and he did Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, Pocahontas, Hunchback of Notre Dame. And he started off with Little Shop of Horrors.
Oh, really?
Yeah. But he won Best Song. He won 2 Oscars, A Whole New World and Best Music.
Oh, so yeah. Well, I can understand that.
This is absolutely it. And he said the mix of Middle Eastern and jazz was like the inspiration for the tone of this film.
Oh,
and
right.
I love that. Yeah.
Yeah.
He was drawing inspiration from Fats Waller. I'm not sure who that is. I think it's a jazz artist.
Okay.
But Brad Kane and Leah Salonga were the singing voices for Aladdin and Jasmine.
Yeah.
And they're just perfect. It's just the best version of any Disney song I've ever heard. So nice.
Yeah, it's
I could
really
listen
good.
To it all day long. Yeah.
Well, the voice of Princess Jasmine, Linda Larkin, apparently her voice was too high. She had to actually try to lower her voice to speak as the princess.
Oh, right.
That was
okay.
My understanding. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
But doesn't bother me. But.
And there's a bit of sadness in the music of this film. Howard Ashman, he died of AIDS at 40,
oh,
and he
really?
Was the writer of the A Friend Like Me. And Alan Menken was like closely worked with him, and he said A Whole New World, he actually, it was gained him some confidence. There's a different sort of meaning for him, that there could be new chapters in his life after the fact that he lost his friend Howard.
Oh, really?
So that's quite nice as well.
Wow. Oh, it's really, you know, you hear these little stories and it kind of makes sense that things are the quality that they are. You know, people are bringing their lives into this stuff.
Yeah, yeah. But then he does the apple thing and she recognizes it and then they kiss.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. It's with Disney, you know, love happens pretty fast.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's when it all is, that's the peak. So that's your, that's the climax of the positive. And now it's time for things to get a bit, to go downhill.
Yeah, the Jafar, and he calls him Prince Abu Boo. He's so scathing.
So good. Just the way that he says that is so good.
Abu Boo. And he catches him, throws him in the ocean. It's so dramatic. And Genie saves him from drowning.
Yeah.
It was such a nice moment.
Mm.
I'll take that as a yes.
Yeah, yeah. That's it. Very fast, but well done. Yeah.
And then they hug. So there is like, I don't know, there's like this sort of dramatic element to Robin Williams. It's not all about the eccentric sort of raving. He can act as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
He says, oh, I'm getting kind of fond of you, kid. Not that I want to pick out curtains or anything. Like, you know, there's that emotion and it comes across in his voice. It's not just, you know, it's not just facial stuff.
No, it's good. Yeah, he is. Yeah, yeah, he was a talent. Real talent.
Yeah. And at this point, moving along quickly, Jafar gets outed when Al breaks the scepter.
So when does Act 3 start?
Well, I sort of had it when Jafar gets in power.
Yeah.
I thought.
So sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
Go for it. What was your Act 3?
Oh, I flew in a giant penis and froze my nuts off. Or should I say, I flew in a giant penis and froze my nuts off.
What is that from? Is that from something?
No, it's just, you know, there's like the, you remember when Jafar just turns into the magician and shoots him off in that, the tower,
oh,
and it lands
right,
in the
yeah,
snow?
Yeah. I was trying to join the dots.
So where did this come from?
Act 3. Yeah, yeah. I like that. I like that punchline. I got a steering wheel in my pants. It's driving me nuts.
What was yours?
I just had Act 3. What's up, pussycat? I can't do Jafar. But he says it so well.
Yeah,
pussycat.
Yeah, yeah. That's true. That's true.
But he becomes Sultan and then Sorcerer.
He's pretty like, pretty quick with what he wants. Pretty quick to get through the wishes.
Yeah, it moves along really quick. And I love the puppet ruler, Wanna Cracker.
Oh, it's so good.
Yeah, he's just rubbing
crackers
down his throat.
Stuffing crackers. Oh, man.
Yeah, there it is. Now, Pussycat, tell me more about myself. So gross.
Oh, man. Yeah. Yeah.
But he turns into a snake. Oh, I don't even remember that part.
Yeah, yeah. How snake-like he can be.
The music was so great in the climax, yeah, I had dramatic. To write down, because there's the theme melody from A Whole New World in the dramatic climax. I thought that was genius, man.
Mm.
And, you know, this is when Jafar's becoming the genie. Mm. It's like escalating. Yeah. And ultimate cosmic powers, itty-bitty living space.
Yeah, good call.
And they kept that quote in the new film, which was nice, I thought.
Yeah, callback. Not done as well.
Not done as well at all. And then when he sets the genie free, it's such a lovely moment, man. I love that.
Yeah. No, it's really good.
Even in the new film, they paid homage to that because...
They did.
That was like the emotional climax. And Will actually did a really good job as an actor there. He really shone.
That's it. That's sort of like... I wouldn't say that he did a bad job. I just think that it wasn't particularly well directed. I thought... that there were subplots in there that were whacked in. I don't know why they were whacked in, but they were.
Mm.
You know, the whole, I had so many things.
Well, there was a more complex relationship between the Sultan and Jafar. The Sultan is more fleshed out too. You know, they were talking about how his wife was killed and, like, you know, the Jafar wanted to invade his wife's land, and there was actual sort of heated discussions there, whereas the Sultan in the animated movie was just a sort of dim-witted childlike character.
Yeah.
So there was some drive there, which was kind of interesting.
Oh, yeah, I guess so. But I felt that it just, all of that stuff just didn't seem to need to be in there. But maybe that's just how I felt about it, because I was comparing it too hard to the original.
Right.
But I guess there was just some stuff in it that was just so glaring. I don't know. Some people might have liked the subplot about now a woman can be sultan and all of that stuff, and they had a song about it. And I just...
Yeah, that was... Yeah, seems a little forced. And she wasn't the greatest either singer or actress, in my opinion.
I think that's it. I think a lot of it just seems to come across as forced.
Yeah.
And like things that I had was like, wow, let's explain everything. Please, we're so stupid. What, the genie and the storyteller are the same? I would never have guessed.
Right, right.
Let's take the you should be free to make your own choice to a whole new level.
Yeah. And just like slam it down your throat like a cracker.
Yeah.
But I did like Jafar's backstory. That was kind of cool. He was a thief too. You know, steal a kingdom and you're a statesman and be the most powerful man in the room or you're nothing. But they sort of overdid it. It was a nice line to have in there, but then they just sort of...
There were too many... like that, the character of the... Like, I must admit, some of it I just skipped because I just couldn't take it anymore. But like they had his like soldier, like one of the guards as a character, and yeah, they added all these characters.
Well, I did like the handmaidens character, Nassim Pedrad, because she's from Saturday Night Live.
Yeah.
She had some great lines. We have spoons.
Right.
Yam jams.
Yeah, I think she was good. Yeah. Tiny, tiny spoons.
And the yam jams. Did you hear that one? She got so excited about yam jams. He's just making up lines.
Yeah, yeah. I kind of wanted to like the Aladdin character, but I found it really hard.
Oh, yeah. There was something about him. Hey, I couldn't put my finger on it, but...
He was probably a sociopath, and you can sort of tell through it. It was just a poor acting. I don't know. But
I like that Will Smith rapped at the end. Did you hear that? Did he blake it to the end?
When did he rap?
Right at the credits.
Oh, no. I couldn't take any more.
But it reminded me back of his...
He does it in...
Boom Shake the Room.
I think that's in his contract. It's got to be in his contract. You watch every single film with him and he's rapping in the credits.
He's rapping. But it was quite good because he did sort of riffing of rappers. Like, he did a bit of Kanye, a bit of Snoop Dogg. That was pretty...
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Maybe that... So, was that the best part of the film, was it?
Maybe. Yeah, maybe. It was pretty rough. Let's just be honest about it. It was a rough experience.
I don't want to go into too much on the review because there's so much that could be said. And to be honest, it's really about this film, which is awesome. And, you know, it's such a great film from the childhood that... I watched it recently with my niece and nephew when I was babysitting them.
Oh, cool.
And, they loved it. Absolutely loved it.
It is such a great film. And, the line, we're just up to it. You know, he sets the genie free and is like, no matter what anyone says, you'll always be a prince to me.
Mm.
Oh, it's so sweet.
Yeah.
There was this thing. It's this guy. He's just started his YouTube channel. It's called Nerdstalgia.
Okay.
And it's really good analysis, breaking down the genius of Genie and Robin Williams and the dynamics of his voice acting. But he sort of summed it up well. He says, I'll always know that voice. And all too often we think of, you know, I'll never forget you. Your memory will live on in me. But millions, including myself, he says, remember the genie, Robin Williams, and it's a part of us. You know, his presence, his talent, forever living on in every single person that got to see a struggling genie finally set free.
Oh, that's pretty nice.
Yeah, it's pretty nice. Hey, it sums it up to me. It's not so much about the romance, this bromance thing, man.
Oh, man, I fancied myself as a little Aladdin, I must admit, when I was watching the film because, the princess and all of that type of stuff. I just love that type of story so much.
Yeah.
But, yeah, Robin Williams just, may live on in everyone's memory.
Yeah. Did you have any final sort of thoughts? How did this rate on your nostalgia meter?
I'd give it a 10 out of 11.
Yeah, awesome.
I won't give it 11, but it is something that is eminently returnable. You know, you can turn it on and find yourself watching the whole thing.
Yeah.
Memorable music, fun characters. It's just great pacing.
Yeah.
Yeah, just a great film. Just love it. And, it was a guilty pleasure when I was growing up, you know, pretending to be a man. And now that I'm a man, I'm not ashamed to say how much I love this film.
Oh, that's nice. That's awesome. And it's good that you're sort of continuing the cycle with your brother's kids as well.
Yeah, yeah. No, looking forward. Yeah.
But I did want to say with this film that... when we chose this film, we thought it would be a bit of a throwaway one. You know, we could whip it out quickly. But man, when I started watching, it just hit me, man. Robin Williams, it's such a sad story.
It is incredibly sad.
His life was tragically cut short by suicide at the age of 63 in 2014. Rest in peace, Robin.
Mm.
But he's been such a huge influence on my life. You know, Good Will Hunting, Hook, Mrs. Doubtfire. 1 Hour Photo was one of his that I watched with my mum, and she loved that. It's a thriller that she really liked.
I've heard it's really good.
Flubber.
Or that he's really good in it.
Oh, he's so good in it. It's worth checking out. Mm. Flubber, Jumanji, Birdcage, 9 Months, Fish King, Cadillac Man. And it hit close to me because, he suffered from addiction and depression, anxiety, and sort of towards the end, paranoia. And he sought treatment through prescription medication, but also yoga and meditation in the end.
Oh, really?
And rehab and things like that. And I suffer from some pretty hefty depression and I'm going through some, right now. And there's such a stigma around mental illness and vulnerability in general. By admitting that we aren't okay, we put ourselves in a position of vulnerability and
we
feel ashamed for admitting it. But absolutely, I think that it has to be changed. There has to be a shift, and now is the time when we all have to do our thing. And so there's hashtags now. There's Beyond Blue. They have smashed the stigma. Such an Aussie.
Oh, really?
Smash it, man. Smash the stigma.
Put a stigma on the Barbie.
That should be the new one. But I was thinking, in an ideal world, what would the conversation be if Robin was still here? It's like, Robin, how are you? Oh, I'm terribly depressed. Are you getting help? I'm ashamed to. I find it too hard to do so myself. you need support right now. It's okay to stop everything you're doing and get the support structures that you need in place. Mm. Like, get your life back in balance, because there's so much positivity in your being. The world needs you, and the world will gladly support you through this time of imbalance. Mm. Like, crowdfunding for mental illness, why is it not a thing? It's okay to ask for help. Mm. And yeah, it just sort of breaks my heart that he sort of slipped through the cracks. And while recording this movie, Robin Williams frequently received calls from Steven Spielberg, who at the time was working on the Holocaust film Schindler's List, 1993. He would put him on speakerphone so he could tell jokes to the cast and crew to cheer them up. Some of the material that he used was material that he said he was using for this film.
Oh, really?
So sad. Because in many ways, who was there to cheer Robin up? Mm.
I think for me, talking about depression and anxiety, I think a lot of the stigma around it is a person's ability to function or be relied upon. In a work environment where people are afraid to talk about those things, there is a lot of stigma attached to it, but also a lot of... I think people are getting better, but I think that there still is a lot of lack of maturity around understanding and approaching depression and anxiety for people who, even people who suffer it, look at other people who suffer from it, because it's the whole admission that it's actually happening and how to deal with that and how other people deal with that, or not knowing how to.
Mm.
An example for me is actually... My wife, as a lawyer, spoke to some lecturers about in the past about, you know, having kids and what it has an impact on your ability to get a job, and, you know, and a lot of the lecturers that she spoke to, and these are women telling her that, you know, it's going to, that, you know, you have a choice between having kids or having a job in law. And that's changing now. It's a lot more accepted, but this is only a couple of, you know, this isn't going back, you know, 20 years or anything like this. This is only a short period of time.
Yeah, it's awful, hey.
Attitudes are changing. It's just, and I think we are going in a good direction. It's just the problem is that because we're people, it just happens really slowly.
Yeah.
And I think it's just being able to find people that you can talk to about this stuff and who will accept you. You know, there's a lot of drive towards making it better. I just think that we're all growing in our levels of maturity of how to deal with not just our own depression and anxiety, but experiencing it in other people and knowing how to be supportive and understanding and helping them to function when, you know, they feel that they can't. Because sometimes, you know, you need to just say, look, go have a break, have time away, come back when you're feeling better. Or, look, you're feeling bad. How can we make something work for you, even though you're in this position? And, you know, I think it's a long road. But I think that there's so much more acknowledgement that people suffer from depression and anxiety. I just think knowing how to deal with it in society is the biggest problem.
Mm, absolutely, yeah.
So what did you rate out of this film?
It was very high on my nostalgia meter, I got to say. Mm. I just love the Aladdin genie arc. There's so much love there. It's a beautiful thing.
Mm.
And yeah, it is about Robin Williams, and just like it was the ideal platform for him to showcase just like how quick-witted he was and the phenomenal impressions that he could just whip out at that quick-witted pace. So it's bouncing back and forth and you're sort of keeping up, you know, you're trying to anyway. Mm. Oh, what's that reference? What's that from? It sounds so familiar. And like you're trying to, it's sort of, that's the key to his genius, I think.
Mm.
So yeah. Love you, Robin. Miss you, bro.
Yeah,
man.
Oh, yeah. My gosh. Oh, at least we got films to look back on him for.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks so much for watching this one, man.
Yeah, thanks for the suggestion. It's awesome. So, next film.
It's one of yours. It's Watcher in the Woods from 1980.
Oh, I'm looking forward to it. I haven't actually watched it. Actually, I'm going to have to figure out how to find it. It's a Disney horror film. Cannot wait.
I've never heard anything about this.
I know. Let's hope it's not as bad as the toy, but
oh no, yeah, no, it sounds good. Disney horror, man.
Mm.
And it had an impact on you?
Oh, yeah, man. Love it. Love it.
Yeah, love it.
Another one of those early horror film.
Oh, right, right.
Love things for me, you know.
Oh, sweet. Looking forward to it.
Yeah. Well, thanks, man. Thanks for picking this, and thanks to everyone for listening to us and making it through our singing, because if you're reaching this point, then somehow you'd manage to.
Thanks, everyone. Good night.
Good night. Stopping, huh?
Stopping. Now.
Stopping.
Good morning, Vietnam.
Good morning in the morning, it's the morning. Okay.
Hold your breath, it gets better now that you've tuned on in and heard us sing.
Okay, we're using yours.